criminal bankruptcy. Hello, I'm John Cook, Director of Judicial Education here at the Federal Judicial Center. Welcome to this Federal Judicial Television Network broadcast on agricultural bankruptcy under Chapter 12 of the Bankruptcy Code. Before I begin the discussion, let me cover a few procedural points. Today, June 30th, 1999, we're broadcasting live and with 10 sites in an interactive mode. We're pleased to welcome those 10 sites and look forward to hearing from all of you from Maryland to California during the next hour. For those of you at those sites, please identify yourself and the site when you speak to us. A few other points to remember. Some of you have an on-off toggle switch on your microphone. Please make sure that's in the off position throughout the broadcast. Use the push-to-talk bar to be heard in studio and on the air. Pushing the push-to-talk bar will mute the sound on your TV monitor. If it fails to mute the sound on the monitor, please turn the sound down on the monitor when you're speaking so as not to create feedback. Also, if that happens, you should check with AT Products because there's a flaw in your system. If you see the timeout signal, that means that too many people are trying to speak at once. At that point, please release the push-to-talk bar and let our faculty sort out who should go next. If you don't have push-to-talk, you can still participate by faxing questions or comments to us using the number on your screen. For all sites, if you have problems with audio or visual transmission, please call SpaceNet Incorporated at the number now on your screen. Finally, it's important for us to know what you think of today's broadcast. Please complete an evaluation form and send it to us. Your site coordinator should have copies of the form, or they can be found at the center's site on the JNet. If you can't find a form, I'd still appreciate your comments in the form of a letter to me here at the center. Now it's my pleasure to introduce our faculty for today, Judge Thomas Small from the Eastern District of North Carolina, and Judge Robert Kressel from the District of Minnesota. Judge Small.
Thank you, John. Today, Bob Kressel and I will be discussing agricultural bankruptcies, primarily Chapter 12 cases, with judges from 10 districts around the country. Of course, lately,
Board of Directors.
I've heard that from several lenders in our area that they actually like Chapter 12, and they would rather than enter into an agreement, they would like the debtor to be in Chapter 12. At least they have the protection of a Chapter 12 trustee.
And like everything else, once the people know what the rules are in Chapter 12, they can design their lending and the interest rate accordingly. So I don't think it's certainly dried up credit at all. U.S. trustee districts has the option to appoint a standing trustee similar to the Chapter 13 standing trustee, or go with individual trustees. Now, in Minnesota, we have standing trustees. They were all picked from the panel of Chapter 7 trustees, so they're all former Chapter 7 trustees. They're all lawyers. Do I gather, John, from what you're saying, that your standing trustee has a different background than that? Emphasize enough how important the trustee is to the success of Chapter 12. It's the key player, I guess, alongside of the family farmer. But the most important function that I think that the trustee performs is monitoring what happens after confirmation, making sure the debtor does what the debtor is promised to do in the plan. I know we have a very high confirmation rate in our Chapter 11 small business cases, but
It's a disadvantage in that it creates additional expenses for the debtor.
Well,
Tom's talking about the fee, the trustee's fee, which the attorney general sets again in U.S. trustee districts up to a maximum of 10%, and I think it's probably set at 10% most places, which raises the trustee monitoring. The first question becomes, what extent can debtors make payments directly to creditors and bypass the trustee? And I think the circuits are split on that, but to the extent they're allowed to do that, of course, it reduces the advantage that, that Tom mentioned of trustee monitoring. But the second important question is, on what is the 10% trustee fee assessed? Do you assess it on payments trustee or on payments made by the trustee to creditors? And you might think on first blush it really shouldn't matter, but it does, because if it's being assessed on the payments that the debtor makes to the trustee, if the trustee takes 10% of that, then the debtor has to make increases payments by 10% to cover that fee. And then the trustee wants a 10% on that part. And if you do the arithmetic, the cost to the debtor percent. So it matters, and the circuits are split on this. The 10th Circuit says it's, yes, it is the 11.1%, but the 8th Circuit has said no, it's 10%. So there's a lot of variation out there and a lot of room for debtors to play around with their plans to deal with the fee. Of course, have any comments about the status conference or preliminary pretrial conferences? Let's turn now to some pre-confirmation issues.
Well, because the Chapter 12 is on such a fast track, the statute requires the debtor to file a plan within 90 days of the filing of the case unless they get an extension from the court. The statute requires the court to have a confirmation hearing within 45 days thereafter. So you can see that things are moving rapidly, and that's exactly as Congress intended, of course. It was hoping that as a trade-off for some of the for the loss of some of these creditor rights, such as voting and being subject to some more severe cramdowns, that things would move more quickly, creditors wouldn't be held up so long. And it was also Congress
That's the bad news. The good news is it seems to be that most creditors and their lawyers or lessors and their lawyers don't know about it either. So the case just seems to slide through on everyone's assumption that the lease is still valid. Let's talk now about some plan provisions. As you know, there's a disposable income requirement in Chapter 12 as there is in Chapter 13. And how is that dealt with in the Well,